This year marks the 50th anniversary of the moon landings, and to keep you inspired to keep looking up, we're giving away some moon merchandise, including a Celestron telescope, Blu-ray copies of the newly released Apollo 11 film with never-before-seen Apollo footage, lithographs signed by the film's director, and theatrical posters. So, to enter, take a photo of the moon and post it to Twitter or Facebook with the hashtag #KeepLookingUp and tag tomorrow. The sweepstake ends May 28th, midnight Pacific time, and is open to US residents. Now let's get this space news for May 22nd, 2019 started. And to give us our space traffic report, here's Carrie Ann.
A Long March 3C rocket took to the skies, lifting the latest satellite in China's Beidou constellation. Liftoff occurred on Friday, May 17th at 1548 Universal Time, from the Zhejiang Space Center in China. The Beidou constellation is China's version of GPS, or Global Positioning System, and is already providing navigation services over Asia-Pacific, with an expected worldwide coverage happening sometime in 2020. This is the second of between 8 to 10 Beidou satellites expected to launch in 2019.
3, 2, 1, 0.
Turning our attention to India, we have a Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, or PSLV, that lifted off the Satish Dhawan Space Center on Wednesday, May 22nd, at midnight Universal Time. Aboard was RISAT-2B, or Radar Imaging Satellite. RISAT-2B is the fourth unit of the RISAT program. As an Earth observation satellite, it will be used for reconnaissance, strategic surveillance, and disaster management. The Indian Space Research Organization, or ISRO, launched the first radar satellite in 2009 and is planning 4 or 5 more radar satellite launches this year alone. Now let's hand it over to Lisa for a quick update on the science happening aboard the International Space Station.
Humanity's Orbital Science Outpost has been working really hard this week to do experiments that will enable humanity to move further out into the cosmos. If you've ever had a blood draw at the doctor's office, you'll know just how much information this bodily fluid can provide. Our blood provides a snapshot of our health, from liver function, cholesterol, electrolyte levels, and the concentration of red and white blood cells. Our blood can help diagnose what's wrong pretty fast. But in space, with no machines available to test their blood, astronauts would freeze their samples and wait months for it to be returned to Earth and analyzed. This isn't ideal if we truly are to become a spacefaring species. This week on ISS, astronauts performed calibration tests on the BioAnalyzer, a device the size of a video game console provided by the Canadian Space Agency. Using just a finger prick of blood rather than a full-size needle, the device provides results in just 2 hours. In the future, it will also be used for saliva and urine samples. The device will also be trialled on Earth in emergency disaster situations and remote areas that don't have easy access to medical diagnostic laboratories. And you might be surprised to learn your favorite food container company, Tupperware, is helping humanity become better gardeners in space. The Veggie Ponds 2 experiment finished up last week, growing red romaine lettuce and Mizuna mustard greens in a new type of growth container. Previously, astronauts would water plant pillows with a syringe, but the water wouldn't distribute evenly to all plants, meaning some grew a lot worse than others. NASA collaborated with TechShot and the Tupperware Corporation to create a system using absorbent mats and surface tension to wick water to plants evenly without needed maintenance from the crew. So, thanks to the International Space Station, we're learning how to grow food for future space explorers and how to keep astronauts healthy as they begin to live their lives off our home planet. Speaking of things that grow, here's Sarah to talk about our expanding universe.
What do we think we know about the universe? It's really big? Check. We live on a planet, in a solar system, in a galaxy, in the universe? Also check. How about the physics at work in our universe? Check? Not so fast. We have a very large and unignorable disagreement between what we think we know and what we are observing, and this disagreement may mean we need to update the age of the universe. The universe is expanding at a rate of 67 kilometers per second per megaparsec, or it's expanding at 74.3 kilometers per second per megaparsec. The problem is, both are right, depending on where you look, or rather, when you look. On April 25th, Dr. Adam Rice of Space Telescope Science Institute announced they used the Hubble Space Telescope to refine the distance measurement to 70 Cepheid variable stars in the Large Magellanic Cloud and compared those distances to supernovae and more distant galaxies. This refined distance measurement was used to refine our current rate of expansion of the universe. We get an expansion of 74.3 kilometers per second per megaparsec. Great. So, if we roll back the universal clock, we should see the universe expanding at the same rate at the beginning. Since the laws of physics as we know them predict that the universe can't change acceleration rate without energy being poured in from somewhere else. The good news is that we have already done that. The Planck telescope was designed for just that thing. It mapped the matter and energy distribution of the early universe and measured its acceleration during its nascent period. The acceleration Planck measurement gave us? 67 kilometers per second per megaparsec. Cosmologists have known about this measurement mismatch for years, but up until now, the error bars on the results have left room for the reason behind the disparity to be faulty data. What Rice's team have done is remove any doubt. With our current understanding of the physics of the universe, it looks like the universe has accelerated its acceleration, which is extremely unlikely. This means we've missed something, and that is an exciting prospect for scientists, or knowledge explorers, as I'm dubbing them. There's nothing more exciting than an unanswered question, and there are plenty of unanswered questions out at Pluto. For that, we go to Jade.
Ever since New Horizons zoomed past Pluto back in 2015, scientists and the public alike have been captivated by the fascinating diversity on this dwarf planet's surface. From towering mountains of ice to an adorable heart emoji-shaped landmark, what was once thought of as a barren wasteland is now considered one of the most diverse bodies in our solar system. And today, I'm here to tell you that that beauty might not just run skin deep. As a matter of fact, Pluto might be just as captivating on the inside as it is on the outside. Scientists have previously speculated that Pluto may have a subsurface liquid water ocean located in the Tomba Regio underneath Sputnik Planitia. But hold on, Pluto is freezing cold and not to mention tinier than our own moon, so wouldn't an ocean have frozen over hundreds of millions of years ago? Well, yes, unless you have something insulating the ocean and keeping it fluid, which is exactly what a recent study in the journal Nature Geoscience proposes. This cozy layer of gas is comprised of clathrate hydrates, which are gaseous molecules trapped in a molecular water cage. In this case, the imprisoned gas happens to be methane that originated from Pluto's core. Because gas doesn't transfer heat very well, that makes it an ideal insulator. With this protective layer between the water and surface ice, the ocean could have remained liquid with the heat left over from Pluto's formation. Computer simulations show that without this layer, any subsurface ocean would have most likely frozen over quite a while ago. This also happens to allow for previous hypotheses to fit in as well, such as there being a certain percentage of ammonia concentration in the water, acting like nature's antifreeze. This model is also consistent with the unique atmosphere of Pluto, which is low in methane but unusually rich in nitrogen. As a primordial trio of gases emanated from the core, nitrogen, which doesn't really like being trapped in these cages, escaped into the atmosphere, leaving carbon monoxide and methane gas to serve as the buffer between ocean and ice. And this model isn't exclusive to just Pluto. In fact, it can be applied to other icy bodies in our solar system and beyond, meaning that the universe might be a lot wetter than previously thought. And where there is water, there is the chance that there also might be life. Now, venturing on from the ultra cold to the super toasty, we have this week's Space Weather Report with Dr. Tamitha Scove.
Space weather this week has definitely calmed down from last week. As we switch to our front side sun, you can see regions 2740 and 2741 rotating off of the Earth-facing sun and onto the sun's backside. Now, they are still being active, and we've seen them fire off some solar storms, so we're going to be anxiously waiting for them to rotate back into stereo's view so we can see what's going on. But meanwhile, the rest of the disk looks pretty dim right now. We've only got a little bit of a remnant
slit coronal holes that are going to be sending us pockets of fast solar wind over the next couple days that could bump us up to active conditions at high latitudes, but that's about it. Now, as we switch to our backside sun, well, the view isn't much better. We really are looking at a dim sun back here. We've got a little bit of a pocket of a fast solar wind going to be coming from a coronal hole that's rotating into Earth view, so that could bring us a little bit more activity, but definitely no more active regions for the next week or so. So amateur radio operators and emergency responders, you're going to have to be dealing with low solar flux easily over the next 2 weeks. And now for your Martian Minute. It's been about a month since we last checked in at the Red Planet, and it's spring in the Northern Hemisphere. But that means dust storms. And remember, we lost opportunity to a dust storm just last year. So how are our two rovers faring? Well, as we look at Mars Reconnaissance Observer data, indeed we do see that dust storms are picking up in the Northern Hemisphere just as scheduled. But as far as InSight and Curiosity, well, they still look to be in the clear. In fact, at InSight's location at Elysium Planitia, it's sunny with a high of minus 6 degrees Fahrenheit. That's about minus 21 degrees centigrade. And the winds, they're breezy, but they're only about 10 miles an hour out of the southwest. For more details on this week's space weather, including some gorgeous aurora photos from field reporters all over the world that caught this last recent big solar storm, come visit my channel or check me out at spaceweatherwoman.com.
That's our news program for this week, but the excitement continues this Saturday at 1800 Universal Time. This week, we're talking with iSpace. They absorb members of a former Google Lunar XPRIZE team and are now working on lunar transportation and in-situ resource utilization. If you won't be able to watch live, just drop your questions into the comments below, and we'll work to pull the great ones into the live show itself. And I want to give a huge thanks to all the citizens of tomorrow for helping make this Space News episode happen. Without you, we wouldn't be able to bring you the latest galactic updates week after week. To find out how you can support the shows financially, head on over to patreon.com/TMRO. We're almost completely crowdfunded, and every dollar helps. If you can't afford to contribute with money, we can always use help with graphics, coding, and research. To offer your support and time, just head on over to community.tmro.tv and let us know what you'd like to do to help out. Thanks for watching this week, and we look forward to seeing you on Saturday.